Padre. Padre, ¿por qué? Ayúdame. Padre, ¿por qué? Padre, ¿por qué? ¿Por qué me has abandonado? Ayúdame, Jesús. Ayúdame. Padre, ¿por qué? Ayúdame, Jesús.
Heavenly Father, I thank you for bringing my sister here today in your house and in your church, that we may be able to pray over her, that whatever is going on in her life, you brought her here to us today, and all of my brothers and sisters here, we could pray for her. So Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I intercede for her, and I remove everything that's going on in her life, that by the end of today, she'll walk out of here brand new. And I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, amen.
All right, hey, aren't you thankful for the cross? Cross means everything. We're in our series at the foot of the cross, and we're gonna be looking at a little bit of that more today. Thank God for his blessings, thank God for his cross, and praise and worship. Oh, powerful, powerful presence of God in the house. We appreciate so much all those who minister to us today. Welcome to Faith. Good to have each one of you here. We welcome our online campus. So thank you for watching and tuning in today with us. We begin our series last Sunday. Last week we looked at Jesus was the last Adam to come, the second Adam, and the last Adam. And he came to undo the curse of the mess that the first Adam made in the Garden of Eden. And so Jesus Christ came, and in perfect obedience, he gave his life, he died on the cross, he took our place, and the blood and body of our Savior inaugurated this new kingdom of God that had now come on earth through the Lord Jesus Christ. He's our Savior. In Christ, we are a new creation, so we no longer identify, listen to me, with the old family tree of Adam, number one. We no longer identify with that, our old tendencies, our old thought patterns, our old behaviors, but we are now in a new spiritual family through the second Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's where identity and our identification comes from. Amen. Today I want to take it just a step further, and I want to talk about the victory that we have through the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. The cross, it was an agonizing torture, punishment, reserved for the very lowest and the worst of the worst. The pain and agony that Jesus Christ, the second Adam, went through was absolutely excruciating. They would sometimes hang on the cross for several hours. Jesus only lasted 6 hours on Calvary because of the massive blood loss that he experienced. There was the cat of nine tails that opened up his back. There were the nails that were put in his hand. There were a crown of thorns, probably an inch and a half long, that were pressed into his brow. You can just begin to imagine the pain and the excruciating torture that he went through. Everywhere you look, there was blood. Blood. Bloody cross, blood out of his hands, blood out of his brow. If you ever cut the forehead, you know how profusely that can bleed. You can imagine a crown of thorns pressed into his blood. There was blood everywhere, and the blood would pool up down at the foot of the cross. But this was the altar of God. This was the altar that would pay for my sins. It would pay for my sacrifice. It would be the blood of the perfect, sinless Lamb of God. Now the question for us today is, why did Jesus have to die? Why did he have to go through all of that? Why such a violent death? Well, it's found in our text today, and I want to break it down for you this morning. And once again, if you're taking notes, I encourage you to take notes or follow along on your YouVersion app. Stand with me and let's turn in our Bibles to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2 and verse number 13. And it says there, when you were dead in your sins and in the circumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave all our sins. having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness. Now, there's going to be some legal terminology and courtroom terminology, and you'll see it woven throughout this message today. Having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us, he has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your sweet presence in the house today. Thank you for this awesome privilege I have to bring forth your word today. I need your help. Take us back to Calvary. Open up our eyes. May we see and understand today the power of your blood. And we'll give you all the praise and honor and glory. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Why did Jesus have to die? Why? The natural doesn't seem to make sense, but in Colossians, he cites three reasons why Jesus had to die, and I want to break it down for you. The first is simply this. It's because of the nature of sin, the nature of sin itself. It brought with it a terrible penalty and a terrible punishment. It says in verse 13, and when you were dead in your wrongdoings and the uncircumcision of your flesh. It's because of our sin. Sin is a word that some you don't hear a lot about today, right? People don't want to hear about sin. They don't want to know about it. They don't want to talk about it. They don't want to know about it. It makes them very uncomfortable. We don't want to talk about sin. It's not our favorite topic, especially in a post-Christian society and even in some postmodern churches. Talk about everything else, but don't mention sin. Let's make sure everybody feels good. Make sure everybody's happy and everybody feels good, and let's not discuss sin. In fact, our world has found new words to describe this, what we would call sin. Some people call it a disease. It's a disease. You can't really help yourself. You have some kind of disease. Some call it a maladjustment. Someone call it a neurosis or an addiction, or on and on it goes. But to describe the brokenness evident in human condition, and they have all kinds of opinions about how you can fix it, right? Go to a therapist, see the counselor, express your problems, go to a self-help group, whatever the case may be, but they have no way to really deal with what the Bible calls is sin. It's sin. The Bible contends that underneath all these behavioral disorders lies the reality of the human condition, sin, S-I-N, right? Sin can be defined as disobedience, rebellion, a turning away from God, and a relationship with him. It says in Romans chapter 6, 17, though you used to be slaves to sin, look at that analogy he uses, slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart. Slaves to sin. Sin is more than just a collection of our misdeeds, but literally wants to bind us up and put us into slavery. It is a sinister, violent force from within us that will enslave us and ultimately destroy you and bring death. Sin. It's in us. It's in us. And it wants to bring us into slavery. James 1 and verse 14 and 15 says, each person when tempted, when they are dragged away, look at the language James uses, when you are dragged away by your own evil desires and enticed. Sin is that thing inside of us that drags us away from the presence of the living God, that pulls us away from him and entices us. And then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Sin will kill you. But every one of us struggle with it. It's kind of like, I'm not a fisherman. The fish know when I'm in the boat. They just don't bite my lure, whatever it may be. But what happens, you used to take that hook and you put that juicy big worm over top of that hook. And what does the fish see? He sees that big, juicy, fat worm and he goes after it, unless it's my worm that I put down there. But he goes after it. But underneath is that hook that will hook the fish and ultimately kill the fish. And that's the way Satan does. He tempts us and leads us away, and he makes sin look so exciting and so inviting, and I just gotta have it, and I just gotta do it, and all these kind of things. But in the end, the Bible says, it will kill you. It'll kill you. The power of sin is so seductive, and our enemy is so crafty, our selfish tendencies are so strong that we become deceived, led away by our own flesh. There's a Greek word for deceive or deception. It's the word apateo, something like that. I'm not a Greek scholar. Read that somewhere. You do try it. And it literally means that which distorts. That's which distorts. It's like a mirage, okay? You know, heard about a mirage in the desert, and you're in the desert, and you're parched, and you're dry, and you're thirsty, and you think you see an oasis up ahead, right? And you got the sand and the hot sand, and you've seen the movies. You haven't been there. We prefer our air conditioning, but you've seen the movies, and you see the mirage out there, and that man is dying of thirst, and he runs to the mirage only to get there and find out there's no oasis there, there's no water there, there's no fruit there, only more sand. And he goes a little bit further, and he struggles harder and harder, and he is dying the entire time. And finally, he may be lucky enough to struggle upon a pool of water, right? But the trouble is that water can be laced with cyanide if it is sin. And you can take just a small taste of that cyanide and it will make you sick unto death. It may not kill you if the amount is small enough, but it will attack your kidneys and your liver. But if you take a full glass of that cyanide, it will kill you. Sin is a universal reality that every single human being will struggle with because of Adam number one. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So that begs the question, why doesn't Jesus just snap his finger, right? Snap his finger and eradicate sin once and for all. Why doesn't he do that? Well, that leads me to my second point from Colossians. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. In verse number 14, there are wages, there are penalties for our actions and for our sins. It says in verse 14, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness. There is a charge against every man and woman who has ever lived on the face of the earth, our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. So the first thing is we have a problem with sin. But the second thing is now, because of our sin, there is this legal charge that is against me, that condemns me. It literally goes back to the nature of sin. If God could just forgive everybody with a snap of a finger, it would not change the fact that I still have a sinful heart. He's not dealing with the heart, the internal side of man. And so if he just said, snapped his finger and said, all your sins are gone, voila, you're free, you're great, you're wonderful. The trouble is, I still have that Adamic nature inside of me, and so I need a whole new heart transplant. I need a new heart. It doesn't settle the heart issue. That's why Jesus says, you must be born again. We need a new heart transplant to obey and love him. Now why was such a high price paid of the cross? The blood, the pain, the agony. It goes back to God's universal law of sowing and reaping, reaping and sowing. There are consequences for our actions, and there are consequences for our sins. And if there were no consequences for our sins, good and bad would be impossible to differentiate, because the consequences would be the same. Go out and kill somebody, commit murder, commit a crime, lie, steal, cheat, adulteries, whatever you might think of. If there's no right or wrong, if there's no sin, then all the consequences for all of our actions are literally all the same. It would result in the same outcome. Turn, if you would, to Exodus chapter 34. And I want you to see this. This is kind of the basis where it all comes together. Exodus 34 and verse number 6. And it says in verse 34, verse 6, and he passed in front of Moses proclaiming, the Lord is compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Aren't you thankful that he loves us, that he's slow to anger, faithful, maintaining love, listen to this, to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. That's who God is. That's what God does. Yet, he does not leave the guilty unpunished. Is God loving? Yes, absolutely. God is love. Is God patient towards sinners? Yes. He is patient towards sinners. Yet God does not leave the guilty unpunished. Why? Because justice is rooted in the very nature of God himself. God is a loving God, but he is also a holy God, and he is a just God. If a person confesses in open court, if they said, I've committed murder, killed 10 people, I did it, got the weapon, my fingerprints are all over it, the blood was everywhere, I can describe every brutal detail. And that judge said, hey, no worries, buddy. I get it, you were having a bad day. Go ahead, leave my courtroom. No jail time for you. Right. There would be a crazy, wild outcry across America. There would be riots and fires, cries of injustice, riots in the streets, kind of like post George Floyd. And we remember what was going on when we saw that injustice and what happened in America and the rage that just kind of came out all across our land. If our God lets sin go unpunished, he would not be a God worth worshiping or dedicating our lives to. If God doesn't eventually punish and purge evil from the world, we absolutely have no hope. Now, how many would agree with that? Wouldn't that be a grave injustice to let a murderer go free? Right? Raise your hands. You believe that? Okay. Justice. And here's the deal. We all say, yes and amen. Get that guy. He deserves his punishment. He deserves life in prison. He deserves whatever he gets. But what happens when the judge points his gavel at you? And he says, you're guilty. You're guilty. I'm guilty. And he points his gavel at me, right? Then we cry out for mercy, not justice. When the criminals get what they deserve, we're happy with that. But when God looks at me and all of my sin and says guilty, all of a sudden everything gets kind of muddled in our understanding. We can't deal with that. You see, we want justice for everybody else but ourselves. And for ourselves, we want mercy. Because sin is so pervasive in our world, brokenness, war, rape, murder, adultery, theft, what has happened is over time, our senses has become dulled and our hearts have become hardened. We see it on television, morning, noon, or night. We see it in society. We watch the news. We see sin all around us. We see the brokenness and hurt and pain in our world. And we just kind of become hardened to the effects and nature of sin. Turn, if you would, to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Look, if you would, at verse number 18. He describes this happening. And he says in verse 4 and 18, he says, They are darkened in their understanding and have separated and are separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. So what happens is in our society, we think I'm not a murderer and I'm not an adulterer and I'm really not a bad person and I'm really better than the next guy. And so what we do is we create in our own mind, because of the hardness of our heart, what I call a righteous sliding scale. Right? And somehow at the end of the day, we think we're better than the guy next door. And we conclude like the Pharisee in Luke chapter 18, verse 11. God, I thank thee that I am not like other men. Extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. And we compare our sins to those of others in an effort to make ourselves feel better about my own morality. We're good, and they're all bad. It's quiet in here. Oh my, I've hit a nerve. And we justify and rationalize and we're good and they're bad. But the Bible says, for all have sinned. And because all have sinned, every single one of us, we all need a Savior to free us from the bondage and captivity of ourselves and our sin and death itself and give us a brand new heart. That is our only hope for our sin problem. Because our wages earn death. Paul uses the legal terminology to describe our predicament. He says in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. That's what we earn. That's what our lives earn. And because all have sinned, we have all earned death. Right? So how can a holy and just God be loving and merciful and patient at the same time? How do we reconcile the love of God and the holiness of God for sinful man? How can this happen? Let me tell you how God remedied this. The Bible says he sent his only begotten son into this sinful, sick world. And he steps down from his perfect throne in heaven to live among a broken creation, a fallen creation, an Adamic creation, to be charged unjustly. He was charged unjustly. He was condemned to death by both the Roman government and the Jewish religious institution, who were out to kill him and get rid of him, to take the penalty of God's wrath. It was all placed upon Jesus Christ when he hung on the cross. All the wrath of God for my sins, our sins, he paid the fine. That was the cross. He died for the sin for every man. 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous, Jesus, for the unrighteous, us, to bring you to God. So in the cross, we see both the holiness and justice of God, because sin had to be paid for. But we also see the incredible love and grace and mercy of God to the thousands and thousands and thousands that I read about in Exodus 34 for us. It is all reconciled at the cross. But I want to take it a step further, and the writer of Colossians does that. Look at verse number 15, the third point, the defeat of sin. The defeat of sin. That's why he had to die, to defeat sin. Verse 15, he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, talking about our indebtedness that was against us. When he had disarmed the rulers and authorities, he made a public display of them, having triumphed over them through him. Wow. Now listen to me. Above the head of Jesus was a sign. And on that sign it said, this is the King of the Jews. And so there would be no misunderstanding. It was in three different languages. It was written in Greek, in Latin and Hebrew, all the languages of those who would have been in Jerusalem at that time. Jesus was falsely accused of trying to overthrow the Roman government, so they said in sarcasm, "This is your king, this is the king of the Jews. You see what insurrectionists, what happens to them." Figuratively, though, Jesus took every sin, and there was another list that was there. You couldn't see it, but Paul writes to the Colossians. He says he took with him to the cross. It was nailed to the cross with him, our indebtedness that was held against us, not him. So every sin that I ever did, went to that cross with Jesus Christ. And for anyone who will believe by faith, by grace through faith, would believe on him, they are figuratively, in a way, nailed with Christ to the cross. So when Christ hung on that cross because of my sins and my surrender to him, I hung on that cross with Jesus Christ. And so the Bible says, figuratively, I died with Christ, but I also rose in Christ. Therefore, I can serve him and live for him. Go to Romans, Romans chapter 6. Look at verse number 6. Romans 6 and verse number 6. It says, "For we know that the old self," that's that old Larry, that old Adamic Larry who was after the line of the first Adam, "I know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with." "That we should no longer be slaves to sin." I read earlier, you were slaves to sin. But no longer am I a slave to sin. Why? Because I hung on the cross with Jesus. Because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. On the cross, listen to me, the justice of God and the mercy of God come together. The justice of God was the punishment for my sins meted out on Jesus Christ. The mercy of God was that my sin was paid for and I can be set free through him. Notice the graphic terms of Colossians 2 and verse 15. It says he disarmed principalities and powers. Literally, what he did is he took away the weapons from Satan in my life. What are the weapons of Satan? What are the weapons? I've been reading it to you. Sin and death. So when Jesus Christ hung on the cross and I receive what he did for me, he disarms in my life those two weapons, sin and death. If you are in Christ Jesus, you will never die. Never. You just simply pass from our life on the earth to our new life with him in heaven. You will not experience the second death. Why? Because Jesus took care of it. He disarmed. He took his weapons away. And then he goes on to say he made a public spectacle of him on the cross. When they would have armies would go out and they would fight in these wars and battles in Roman times, what they would do is they would often take the conquered army and then bring them back into the city as a public humiliation to everybody else around that this is a defeated, conquered army. It is very graphic military language. And that's what he did with Satan and the devil. Let them into that city. Into the kingdom of God, saying he's defeated, he's defeated, he's defeated. Look at his chains. And then the third phrase, triumphing over them by the cross. the procession of the captives into the city set off a glorious celebration throughout the kingdom. The enemy's been defeated. He's been beaten. He's done with. His doom has been sealed. And it sets off an incredible celebration in the kingdom. And so Paul purposely uses these very graphic description of how Satan has been defeated through what? The cross. The cross. That's why Jesus had to die. Our victory consists of entering into the victory of Christ. And what the thing is, when I identify with what Christ did on the cross, not only is the old man crucified, the old man is killed, but I also enter into all the spoils of war. Now listen to me here. This is good. This is good, okay? When the conquering army would take another army over, they would take their weapons away from them and disarm them, right? They would also take all of their food, all of their provisions, all of their supplies, all their stuff, and it would be what they would win. It would be their spoils of war. Because I identify with Christ, I also am a participant of all the benefits that the cross has for me. And so I enter into what I call the spoils of war, or the benefits. You say, what are they? Let me tell you exactly what it says. The kingdom of God is what? Righteousness, peace, and joy. The kingdom of God is not about meat and drink and what we do to get by in this earth. The kingdom of God is righteousness and peace and joy. Those are the spoils of the victory that Jesus paid for me. I have his righteousness. I have the peace of God that passes all understanding. I have a joy unspeakable and full of glory, all because of the cross, because the victory he won for me. We can thank God that he has given us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to read Revelation 12:11 to kind of wrap it up. It says the accuser, and by the way, the word Satan, one of the names we use for the devil, it's just really a title, it just means accuser. He's the accuser. The accuser of our brothers and sisters, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. Now I'm telling you, in Revelations, there are several times that you have this feeling that Satan has been hurled down. He was hurled down pre-creation to this earth because he riots in heaven. A third of the devils are cast down with him, right? And he's now roaming upon the earth. And he comes and he deceives Adam and Eve. You get the picture. It's spelled out in the Old Testament. He's hurled down then, but he's got access and he's all over the place. And so he's hurled down again at Calvary, right? The enemy has been hurled down, right? Again, at the cross. And then remember when the disciples came back and they were going door to door and they're casting out demons and sick people are being healed and blind eyes are being opened up and the lame are walking and they're coming back saying, man, this kingdom stuff is amazing. This power is amazing. And they come back and Jesus says, behold, I saw Satan fall like lightning. So every time in our lives, we lay hand on the sick and they recover. We pray for somebody else. Again, figuratively, Satan is being cast down again and again and again. He is a defeated, whooped foe. They triumphed over him, listen to me, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And listen to this. Remember I said the two great enemies are sin and death? And they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. This early church is going to be suffering persecution that would be unimaginable under the Roman Empire. Paul writes Revelation towards the very end of his life. He's probably about 90 years old. It is 60 years after the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And this series of persecution would begin under Nero and each cruel Roman emperor after that. Millions of believers would be killed. But it says they didn't shrink from death. Why? Because they were no longer afraid of death because of what Christ did on the cross and his resurrection. And so for the child of God, we face death entirely differently than anyone else in the world. Now you have the image of a courtroom in Revelation 12:11. And the image of the court is simply this. Satan stands before the court, right? And he's there, and he points out our failures. And he says, I've got all these failures. I've got all the things they did wrong. I got all their indebtedness. Every sin, I've cataloged it. I've kept track of it. I'm going to accuse them. And he brings these accusations into the court of the heavenly realms. And he accuses us before the throne. I just read it to you. Morning, noon, and night, every single day, he is coming after you, child of God. And he wants to bring up your past sins and failures, right? And he says, they're guilty. They deserve death, he shouts out. But God responds, what sins are you talking about? What sins are you talking about? And Satan takes all of his sins. It's the certificate of our indebtedness. And he said, that was already nailed a long time ago to the cross. And in my own blood, I wrote the words, paid in full. Paid in full. They're gone. They're gone. They're gone. I've already taken care of it. Paid in full. Listen, when Satan accuses you, the only defense we have is the blood of Jesus Christ. But what a defense. What a defense. There's a phrase, and some of you have been around Pentecost for a long time. You'll know this phrase. It's called pleading the blood. Plead. Everybody heard that phrase? Plead the blood. Right? Listen to me. Plead the blood literally means exercising my legal rights through what Christ has done. And so I don't stand there with my own defense. I'm a pretty good guy, and I was nice yesterday, and I did this and that, and look how wonderful I am. No, my only defense is to plead the blood of Jesus Christ, that Jesus died for me, that he already paid for my sins. Therefore, listen to me, Satan has no right to rule over me, to accuse me, or to condemn me, because what? I plead the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That cross, this cross, was the ultimate showdown between good and evil. Christ shattered the power of sin and the stronghold of death among all who will repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to me. Now I have a new way to live. Now I'm not bound by that old sinful nature anymore. Now I have a life that's not dominated by the power of sin and the fear of death because of the victory that Christ won. Now I just got to do this. Some of you you're thinking ahead of me. I know your brains are already working. You're coming up with. If the devil's defeated on the cross, why is there still so much sin? Why is there so much death? Why is there so much evil in the world? On the cross, Jesus declared a death blow to Satan. It was the blow that was predicted in the book of Genesis when it says, he, the offspring of Eve, will crush your head to the serpent. Remember that story? Genesis 3. And what happens now is his head has been crushed because of Calvary, and he's bleeding out. You've heard that terminology. He's going to die. It's over. It's finished. He's bleeding out, right? Got the analogy? You've seen enough people get shot on TV. But he is hell-bent on taking every person with him to final judgment. So he's still coming after us. When Jesus brought heaven down to earth, his cross became the beachhead for the church with which to launch our attack. Follow me here. Follow me here. This is good. You've heard of D-Day. It looks like the enemy's going to win. The Nazis are going to win. We're all going to be speaking German. And in a countermeasure, Churchill, president, they get together, military experts, and they say, I think we can attack right here at Normandy, France. and they launched the largest amphibian attack maybe this world has ever seen at one time. And thousands upon thousands of soldiers hit that beachhead. And many, many of them gave their lives. Their blood was spilled. They began to make their way through Europe. D-Day was successful. And they began to make their way towards Germany. I will tell you, after that invasion at D-Day, some of the bloodiest fighting and the most casualties were experienced in the latter part of the war as we attacked and made our way through Europe. But we set France free. We set this one free and that one free. And finally, we arrived at Germany. And when they surrendered, we have what is known as VE Day, which means Victory in Europe Day, right? What happened is the cross was D-Day. It won the battle for all of us and for all of eternity. But Satan is still out there. The victory will be fully realized when Jesus Christ comes back. VE Day. We've had our D-Day. It's Calvary. VE Day. It's a trump of God kind of sound. Dead in Christ are going to rise first, and we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with him in the air, and so will we ever be with the Lord. VE Day is still coming. The victory will be fully realized and manifest when Christ returns, but Satan's defeat, his doom is sealed right now. That's the reason this series has been so important these last 2 weeks. I hope you got it. I hope you got it in your spirit, in your heart. Because when Satan reminds you of your past and he accuses you, you need to remind him of his future. Paid in full, it is finished. The only weapon the devil has left is what is known as deception. And what he tries to do is create fear. And so he brings his accusations. And if you listen to those accusations and buy into those accusations, fear all of a sudden comes into your heart. And so maybe you're afraid. Maybe God really hasn't forgiven me. Or maybe there's a fear that God doesn't approve of me. Or there maybe is a fear that comes in that God really may not love me. Or that you're going to sin and you can't get out of sin. And you're stuck forever and you're trapped in this cycle of addiction forever and ever. But you don't understand the power of the blood and the power of the cross. And the accuser has no hold on you anymore because you died with Jesus. You rose again with him to live that new life led by the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 6:2, since we have died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? Before you were enslaved by the power of sin, you walked in the way of your flesh, the old Adam. But through the power of the cross, listen to me, through the power of the cross of Christ, his blood, and through the power of the Holy Spirit living and working in you, you can go from grace to grace in the fullness of everything that Christ has paid for you already on the cross. 1 Corinthians 15 sums it up this way. Oh, death, where is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? But thanks be to God who gives us the victory, the victory, the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 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 There's an old song. I think we sang it at least once a month in the church I was in growing up. I'm tempted to sing it. I don't want you running out the back door. A little nervous that may happen. But it says, would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious. Oh, you got it now. Sing it again. Oh, you got it. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for your blood. You may be seated for just a moment. Listen, you may be in the house today. You haven't asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart and life. There's no way I'm preaching on the Calvary and the blood and the cross without giving you a chance to ask Christ to forgive you, take your sin away, live inside of your life. It's the greatest adventure you will ever be on and ever walk on, and it's your guarantee of life everlasting and life after death in Jesus Christ. But it all starts with that moment when you put your faith in God. Say, God, I believe you died for me. I believe you love me. I want to give you my life in response. Every head is bowed, every eye closed. Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit of God, have your work. Have your work today. Have your work today. Turn the house lights up as bright as you can get them. I don't want to miss a person. If you're here today and say, Pastor, pray for me. I need to ask Jesus to come into my heart and life. Just raise your hand real high all over this building. I want to know who to pray for this morning. Well, yes, God bless you. Hallelujah. Yes, up top, God bless you. Yes, yes, God bless you. You may slip your hand down. Somebody else. Somebody else. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Anyone else, you'd say, pray for me. I need Jesus in my life. Yes, God bless you. Thank you so much. Hallelujah. Anyone else? Anyone else? Hallelujah. Yes, let's pray together. Yes, God bless you, ladies. Anyone else? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's all help them pray today. Bible says, believe in your heart, right? That Jesus, God raised him from the dead, and believe and you confess with your mouth that he is the Lord, you shall be saved. And so we're going to help you confess with your mouth today by praying and asking God to come in and cleanse us and give us his new life. Dear Jesus, everyone, let's help him pray. Dear Jesus, thank you that you love me so much. I believe you came and you died for me, and you rose again on that third day. And I ask you, Lord, to take all my sins away. Apply that blood into my life that I might be forgiven and cleansed. Come and live inside of me through your Holy Spirit. And with your help, from this day on, I'm going to serve and follow you. Thank you for saving me. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Now listen. Miracles, 5, 6, 7, 8, I don't know how many, 9, 10, but miracles, if you prayed that, took place, the greatest miracle, the transformation, going from death to life. Now, our altar workers are going to come across the front, and we've talked about the power and the blood. Listen to me, if you need healing, it's been provided for by the blood of Jesus Christ. If you need healing today, come and they'll pray with you. They'll anoint you with oil. They'll believe with you. If you're struggling with fear or doubt or oppression, or you're just battling today, maybe you're fearful over your family and what's going on there. Maybe you're fearful of what's to come in your own life. Maybe it's this fear that the enemy is just trying to bring and put all over you. I've got good news. You don't have to carry that fear. You don't have to live under that fear because it's been taken care of on the cross. You just got to enter into what Jesus Christ has already done for you, already provided for you. And so if you need prayer, these altars are going to be open now, and they're going to be open after this service ends, after we close. Now we're going to do something a little different. We're all going to stand up right now, y'all. I know you just stood up, sat down. We're doing church gymnastics here, but I want you to all stand again. There's another song we're going to sing. I'm going to end this a little different today. I just thinking about all that Jesus did, and I was just overwhelmed with thanksgiving. Thanksgiving for the cross, for Calvary, for his blood. Just overwhelmed. And there's a song we sing that talks about our freedom. It says, I thank God, right? And so we're going to sing this song. If you need to get out from your aisles and dance a little bit, move out to the sides and dance. You want to shout a little bit, it's okay to shout. Want to run around a little bit, don't crowd these guys up here. Don't knock them down. We love these guys. But if you want to run around a little bit, it's okay. We're free. We're free. We're free. Think about that. We're free. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.